You found us. Since you're here and we're here, stick around for the next half hour or so. Let's worship the risen Lord and Savior Jesus Christ together. Welcome to Grace United Methodist Church.
We invite you at home to sing with us today, All I Need Is You by Dan Adler.
From Matthew 14, verses 22 through 33. Then he made the disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side, while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone, but the boat by this time was many furlongs distant from the land, beaten by the waves, for the wind was against them. And in the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It is a ghost!" And they cried out for fear. But immediately he spoke to them, saying, "Take heart, it is I, have no fear." And Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, bid me come to you on the water." He said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came to Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying, "O man of little faith, why did you doubt?" And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshiped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." This is the word of God. Thanks be to God.
Now join us in reciting the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
I thought maybe I would bring you to one of my favorite places. Out here on the water, in the kayak. This is where I've spent a lot of time over the last couple of months, just kind of making myself feel better. Today we're talking about a very special story in the Bible where the disciples are out on the boat and Jesus is on the shore, like way over there, and all of a sudden they see him walking on top of the water to come see them. Can you imagine looking way over there and seeing Jesus walking on the water? And then one of the disciples, Peter, decides to walk out to meet him. and he's looking at Jesus, and he's got his eyes on him, and he's walking on the water, and then he looks down. I like being in my boat, but the water I'm in has snapping turtles and alligators in it. I'm much safer in the boat than I am down there. And I think Peter thought the same thing. And so when he looked down, he started to get scared and he started to fall under the water. But when he put his eyes back on Jesus, he came right back up and was able to get to Jesus. You know, lots of things can scare us in life. But if we keep our eyes on Jesus, then we're gonna be okay. Can we say a prayer and thank him? God, thank you so much for giving us your son, who came here to show us that we don't ever have to be afraid, who showed us through his miracles, his stories, and just his love, how much you love us. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
What a day we're living in. Things are changing so much, so fast. It can be a little bit scary and a little bit intimidating. Think about it in matters of race, politics, relationships. On so many fronts, we got groups that are saying over here, this is right, this is the way to go. And yet other groups over here saying, no, that's not right, this is right, this is the way that we should go. So how am I supposed to know what to think? If we don't have a good foundation that is our source, that is like the foundation of our house, it's our source of our thinking and our sense of what is good and bad, what ought to be or ought not to be, we're going to be lost and just swept along. We'll either be swept into some places that we ought not to be, or we'll be left behind when some of the changes proposed that might be good are coming. So we need that foundation. So, where do I start? How do I decide what's good, bad, right, or wrong in these turbulent days? Do I just go with what I've always thought? Doesn't seem like there's a whole lot of growth in that. Should I go by just what I feel? Well, what I feel can easily change. That can be like building a house on shifting sand. So I'm not sure I want to look to that, though that can be one of the first places. Those can be some of the first places we go to. Let me suggest another starting place that is more permanent, that's more sure. How about we take as our foundation for what we think is good or bad, right or wrong, how about if we first see who God is? and let that be our guide. Let's talk about that in a few moments that we have in front of us. The disciples were in a boat out at sea. They'd been fighting against a storm for quite some time. I've lived around water most of my life, and I can tell you, there are very few being afraid like being afraid on the water. Well, that's where they were. They were scared to death in the storm. Wouldn't you know it? In the storm, Jesus comes walking to them on the water. Scared them to death. They thought it was a ghost. I mean, who walks on the water for mercy's sake? Once they saw that it was Jesus and their hyperventilating slowed down, Jesus invites Peter to get out of the boat and join him on the water. There is nothing natural about getting out of a boat in the storm and getting on the water, but that's exactly what Jesus invites Peter to do. Now, Peter is scared, but he does what the Lord says. Amazingly, he stays afloat for a moment. Then Peter looks around, and the story tells us that he saw the wind and all that it was doing. He saw the waves that it was stirring up. And he began, as the fear crept in, he began to sink. Now think about this. Peter had seen Jesus do some amazing things. He was in the synagogue one day with Jesus when he saw Jesus heal a man on the Sabbath. That upset the religious sorts quite a bit, but doing this on the Sabbath. But he saw Jesus heal a man with a withered hand. It was withered and then it wasn't. Just at the word from Jesus, Peter saw that. He had seen Jesus heal a woman who had had a flow of blood for 12 years when she only touched the hem of his garment. And she was made well. Peter was there when Jesus healed Peter's mother-in-law of a dangerous fever. Now, all these things he had seen from Jesus before the fear gave way to him as he's standing there on the water. Despite all that he had seen, now Peter, get this, is sunk by what he saw. He saw the wind, he saw the waves, he saw the storm. Peter had seen Jesus do some amazing things, so you would think that with all that Peter had seen, he would be ready when Jesus asked him to do the impossible. But he wasn't. All this that he had seen wasn't enough to bolster his faith to carry him through in this moment. He wasn't ready. Fear took over. Reality set in. Now, wait a minute. I'm not supposed to be able to stand on water. And so he begins to sink beneath the waves. Here's why Peter wasn't ready when the moment came when Jesus asked him to do the impossible. Though he had seen Jesus do a lot of impossible things, there was one life-transforming thing that Peter had not yet seen. He had not seen the resurrection. When you see the resurrection, it changes you. You come away from seeing it different than you came to it. It changes you. Look at the difference we see in Peter after he sees the resurrection. Jason Bradley, writing for Logos Talk, says about this, about the change in Peter. He says this. He said, this brash fisherman who would hide and disassociate himself from Jesus, remember, Peter said, I don't even know him, as Jesus is being arrested. This brash fisherman who would hide and disassociate himself from Jesus becomes the one who stands on the day of Pentecost before a crowd calling 3,000 people to repentance in that one day. Throughout the book of Acts, we see this once fearful hanger-on around Jesus become the bold leader of the early church. He's beaten for Jesus and he's thrown in jail, but he does not back down. Not now, not once he's seen the resurrection. He puts his life on the line to stand up for Jesus. This guy has come a long way from the one who didn't have enough faith in Jesus to stay afloat on the water, and that caused him to sink below the waves. He's come a long way from that happening. I want you to note that when Peter was standing on the water, he was sunk by what he saw. He saw the wind and the waves. But when he saw the risen Jesus, when he saw the resurrection, when he saw who God is, he was changed. He was transformed by what he saw. What brought about this change in Peter? He saw the resurrected Jesus. When you see who God is, it changes you. Think of the amazing ways that other people in Scripture have been changed once they saw who God is. Last week we talked about the prophet Isaiah, who's been called one of the greatest prophets in all of the Old Testament. Think how bold he was. He was telling Israel and Judah back in that day, about 750 years before the birth of Christ, he was telling them, you got to trust in God and in God alone. They were thinking about, the king was making alliance with Egypt so they could stand against Assyria, which made perfect sense just on practical matters. But you see, Judah and Israel were supposed to rely on God alone for their safety and protection. That's what Isaiah said. This guy who was born into comfortable affluence, but yet identified with those who were poor and left out, would stand before kings and take them to task over not trusting God alone. Now, this boldness that we see in Isaiah, it came, I really believe, from one seminal moment in his life. Early on in his writing, in the first of chapter 6, I really believe this is what spurred him forward. Isaiah said this, in the year that King Hezekiah died, I saw the Lord. Isaiah saw who God was, and it changed him. He was never the same after that. Think of Paul. Think how he was changed when he saw who God was. Consider one passage that he wrote, just one. Consider this. In Galatians chapter 3, he said, in Christ there is no Jew or Gentile. I think he used the word Greek in most of our translations, but it means those who were not Jews. In Christ there is neither Jew nor Gentile. Now, this Paul that we first meet in the book of Acts is running around persecuting Christians because he's so zealous for the Jewish faith. He thought these Gentile folks, they didn't have near the standing before God that the Jewish folks did. And then what did God call him to do? To take the gospel of the mercy of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles, those folks that he thought were just out in the cold. What changed him? This change was so deep in Paul that it would have left him unrecognizable to those who had known him before. They would have thought, this guy who was so zealous and on fire for the Jewish faith is now saying Gentiles have a place at the table too. Well, this guy? Are you kidding me? They would have hardly known who he was. What changed him? Well, it happened one day as he was going to Damascus. And he met Jesus Christ, the risen Savior, blocked his path, and he saw who God is. And it changed him. All these people were changed when they saw who God is. That's what turned them absolutely around. That's where we start. In the same way, seeing who God is needs to be the guiding force in our lives in these days when we're trying to decide, what do we do? How do we decide what's good and bad, right and wrong, who's in, who's out? How do we decide that? We begin there by seeing who God is and letting that become, like these people in the Scripture, the guiding force for our life. God, seeing who God is needs to be the guiding force in our lives. In this world where everything is changing so quickly and everything looks sometimes scary, we need to base what we think is good, bad, right, wrong, not on frail human opinion, because human opinion can point this way one day, oh, this is the way we ought to go, and tomorrow can point another direction. It does that. That can make me also, if I just brace it on my opinion or my feeling, just what I've always been taught. Well, what I've always been taught isn't necessarily God-honoring just because I've always thought it. What is permanent is basing what we think on first seeing who God is and then living that out. When we see who God is, it changes you. And then we go about the business, here's what we're called to do of God people, of living out in all that we say and all that we do and what we think, who God is. We live out what we saw. I want you to consider a testimony from a guy named George. I just came across this, just happened this week. He is from Ginghamsburg Church up in Tipp City, Ohio. George had run his life into some very, very bad places. He was into cocaine. He was broke. He and his wife had mutually defined a very unhealthy relationship. Things just weren't going in good directions. There was anger. There was resentment on the part of him and his wife. He had even prayed at one point. He said, God, you either got to take me out of here or you got to save me and change me. One of the two. Well, now God heard that. So Jesus showed up. George had an encounter with Jesus. He saw who God is. And here's what he heard Jesus saying to him. I love you no matter what. No matter how broke you've been, no matter how unhealthy the relationship with your wife has been, no matter the fact that you're on drugs, you haven't messed it up bad enough to change my love for you. I love you no matter what. That told him who God is. And it has become the guiding principle of his life. Now, he decided from that encounter with Jesus when he saw who God was that since God loves him no matter what, he needs to love his wife no matter what. And now he's off drugs, he's back at work, and his relationship with his wife is in the process of healing. Here's what we need to do in these days. We need to take a breath and take a fresh look at who God is. God is the one who takes this failing fisherman who doesn't even trust Jesus enough to stay afloat on the water when Jesus is right there in front of him face to face. He takes that failing fisherman and makes him one of the leaders of the earliest church. It makes him a bold messenger of the mercy and good news that he has to share with the world of his love and mercy and grace. That's who God is. God is one who takes George, who has made a mess of things, and loves him no matter what, right where he found him, and begins to turn his life around. Well, he doesn't love him now that he's turned his life around. He loved him just as much before. That's who our God is. We need to take a look at who God is. That's who God is. And then let that guide what we think, what we do, what we say, what we perceive to be right and wrong, who we perceive to be in and out. We need to see who God is. He is merciful and he is gracious. And the world needs that message right now. That God loves us no matter what. That's where we start in these turbulent days. That's what God calls us to live out. Thanks be to God.
Let us come together now in prayer. Heavenly Father, you are the source of all goodness, wisdom, and mercy. If we never before knew how much we need those great gifts, how much we need you, we know now. This isn't just about our private fears or personal concerns, nor only our church or community.
This is about every person across the earth, together facing the unknown. We are bound together in our vulnerability, gracious Lord. Bind us together by something greater and stronger. Bind us together with cords that cannot be broken because they are tied to your Son, who gave his life for us. Bind us together with him in a fellowship of suffering, suffering with and suffering for our brothers and sisters. Bind us together in a fellowship deeper than our differences and stronger than death. Bestow your spirit of great wisdom and understanding upon all who lead the nations in this time of crisis. Give them every spiritual, moral, intellectual, and social resource they need to act for the good of the people entrusted to their care. Let them be courageous, competent, collaborative, and compassionate as they ponder what course to take. We plead on behalf of the many who are quarantined and isolated because of exposure to this virus, for everyone who is already ill, and for those who are at great risk of severe illness. Hide them under your wings and protection, and grant them healing and hope. Lord, give courage, patience, ingenuity to everyone whose job and business is endangered. Help them move through this quarantine with certainty, and help us to support one another. Most gracious and gentle Father, we pray for the families with children in these difficult days. Some have just one parent. Some are stressed from things ranging from drugs to physical abuse to illness of body, mind, and spirit. Lord, some of those households sit so close to the edge. Let your spirit fall over those troubled waters and give us eyes to see and our hearts ability to respond helpfully and as often as we can. We pray for the one holy Catholic and apostolic church throughout the world and for our own little part within it. Many of our pastors, priests, deacons, and elders feel the physical separation from their congregations and are struggling in ways to minister in this new world. Move through all of those you have called that they may feel your presence and have the wisdom to move the church forward. Keep us steadfast in faith, courageous in hope, and unflagging in charity. And keep us in prayer as your Son taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
As you walk through the troubled waters in the coming week, as you face uncertainty, may you always keep your eyes on Jesus, and may blessings and grace fall upon you. Amen.